Senator Joyce.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. I'd rise tonight to touch base with the issues pertaining to the Murray Darling Basin Plan, for which the number has been announced today. I think it's very important that now this number has been announced, there's a process of negotiation that opens up between the state governments, and to put on the record that we've got to find out exactly where the state governments are, that we are not left in some sort of quandary as to their position, and also where peak industry bodies are on this number, and most importantly, where the towns are. I think it's important at the start that we also get a few other facts and figures out. With the water, every one of us here, to get by, to get through the day, it's going to take you around about 2,000 litres of water for the food you drink, for the clothes you wear. You mightn't think you're consuming that, but you are. It is part of the process. So it's about 700,000 litres of water a year to maintain your lifestyle, to maintain your food, to maintain your clothes. And so we mightn't be directly associated with irrigation, directly associated with water, but if you dig down through it, you most certainly are. And if we note what the 2,750 gigalitres that is the nominated figure at this point in time, and about the in excess of 950 gigalitres that has been already got back through programs such as the Living Murray Agreement, there was about 500 in that. We are talking about 3,500 gigalitres of water. Now that is enough to. That water is what is required to look after, feed and clothe about 5 million people a year. So we have to always look at the other side of this equation. When we're talking about water, when we're talking about the environment, you're also talking about the capacity for us to feed people. And the more we reduce our capacity to feed people, and if we say, well, that's for the benefit of the environment, well, the cost, of course, is that somebody somewhere else in the world who we used to feed, or someone domestically we used to look after, is not being fed, so we're either importing that food, putting that person overseas with the global food requirement, as we know, escalating, putting them at an exposure of starvation, or in some instances, a time of privation death, or forcing up, at the very least, forcing up the price of food and the cost of food in our own nation. So let's talk about the environment, and that's fair, but let's also acknowledge that it is not a one-way street. This is not something that comes with no cost. It does come with a cost. And just because you can't see the cost doesn't mean the cost isn't there. And that's why, as we go forward towards the culminations of negotiations and trying to come to a conclusion on this, that we have to be so careful. The other place, of course, caution is required is in the effect on regional towns. And I think about this not so much about the farmer, because they will be compensated, they'll be paid out, but for the person who lives in the town, the person who has paid a mortgage off on a house and says, well, that house is the reflection of my efforts to pay that house over 30 years, over 40 years. What is reflected in those bricks and mortar is my endeavours. And if you take the economic rug away from this town and diminish the value of that house, then you've stolen off that person, whoever it is. A pensioner who's retired in a country town. Or maybe it's the person who built the motel business up. Or maybe it's the person who built the tyre business up. Or maybe it's the person who bought the chemist shop. But you must accept a responsibility to these people. And that's why we have to be ever so careful about how we manipulate the economic fundamentals of these towns, because there is no way that they're getting compensated. These people are not getting compensated. They just wear the cost. So, noting these two instances, that the reality of the water requirement for the production of food and the water, if this nominated amount and the water that's already come back thus far, has the capacity to deal with, feed with, clothe 5 million people a year, and of course the domestic effects. It does also come into play when people talk about us becoming the food bowl. We're trying to work out how we're part of the Asian century. We're going to be apparently be their food bowl. Well, that great statement. wonderful, but let's put some meat on the bone. How are we actually going to do that if we're closing down our farming productive farming areas? Where is the alternate farming area that we're opening up to compensate for the 5 million people we'll no longer be feeding or clothing for the area we're closing down? If we don't do that, then these are just fallacious statements. Fallacious statements with the expectation that people are naive and they won't actually drill down through the statements and say, well, how on earth could you call yourself providing a food requirement for Asia when you're actually closing your food capacity down? I am very concerned when I see people who are very close to this debate, such as Tony Windsor, making statements that are just completely and utterly factually wrong. And here's a classic one. Mr. Windsor actually had an inquiry into the latest iteration of the Murray Darling Basin Plan, the delivery of an extra 400 gigs of water from $1.7 billion. I don't know how on earth you'd actually do that. The numbers just don't stack up. But in his own inquiry, in his own media release, he gets everything wrong. First of all, he gets the classic one wrong. He puts a media release out on the 26th of October talking about that section, that actual bill, being that he's talking about the sustainable diversion limits that allows the 5% increase and decrease, that the sustainable diversion limit bill had been passed on the 26th. It hadn't. And he was the one who was chairing the inquiry, having a look into it. What a remarkable trick. What a remarkable trick. I think the unfortunate thing, of course, that he also got the figures wrong. He talked about, oh, well, it's 500 gigalitres of water. Well, no, it's not. It's 710. Maybe if his inquiry went for longer than 27 minutes, which is the duration it went for, he'd actually realise that the bill he was talking about hadn't been passed. So, you know, this is a concern, because these people are put forward, sometimes I think pushed forward by the Labor Party, as the oracles to assuage the community and say that everything is fine. Well, the first thing you must make sure is that you get your facts right. And then lately he's come out and said that it was only in this article by Lenore Taylor, where he says, he tells us not to be concerned. He said, well, based on everything Tony Burke has told me, this is a quote from Tony Windsor, and all the figures on the record, the real amount of water that has to be delivered to the environment is at most 800 gigalitres. Farmers should look hard at the actual numbers rather than the rhetoric, because they may never get a better deal than this. Mr. Windsor, 800 metres is more water than the whole of South Australia uses. It's more water than the whole of Queensland uses. Just 800 gigalitres is not just it, that is a substantial amount of water. And please, and I hope this is not the case, but if he thinks there's nothing much to 800 gigalitres, then maybe he would like it to come out of his area and see how they feel about it. I don't think it would bring economic devastation. So on the eve of where we're trying to get to a point where we get to give our best endeavours to get to some conclusion. And why? Why would I, as part of the coalition, as representing that ministry, move in a direction of trying to work as best I can with the Australian Labor Party, with Senator Feeney and his cohort, to try and bring a resolution? Because I know full well that if I don't, if I'm not part of that process, then the Australian Greens will be. And if the Australian Greens are, and we saw yesterday the perfect example of what happens if you rely on the Australian Labor Party and the Australian Greens, they always get the numbers, and the WEA bill was a perfect example of that. They can get it through because they've got the numbers. But so we must remain at the table in negotiations on this, because the worst thing that could ever happen to a people in regional Australia is if they have to start relying on Senator Sarah Hanson-Young to be protecting the future, the economic viability of their towns. So I say to the people of the basin, We are doing what you asked us to do, to stay at the negotiation table and to try and bring this to some sort of conclusion as best we can. We do not remove the opportunity that if we have to pull out of it, we will, but we will do our very, very best on your behalf to try and come up with some resolution that you can live with.
Senator Wright.
Yes, thank you, Mr. President. In August this year,